Welcome to 558 Parkside Tech, where we talk about everything tech, from coding to design, from the past, the present, and the future of tech. Our goal is to educate the culture. I'm your tech plug, Mike. Let's get it right after the jump.
Yeah, 558 Parkside Tech, in effect, tech, 558 Parkside Tech, in effect, tech, tap in the future. Let me introduce ya, 558 Parkside Tech, about to school ya, 558 Parkside Tech, in effect, tech, 558 Parkside Tech, in effect, tech, 558 Parkside Tech, in effect, tech,
Parkside.
Today we're talking about object-oriented programming. Anyone that jumps into the field today who wants to be a developer would have to get their arms around object-oriented programming. But if I say it another way, to clearly define what we're about to do, it's programming objects. Now, there are four pillars to object-oriented programming. There's abstraction, polymorphism, inheritance, and encapsulation. These are the four primary pillars of object-oriented programming. For those that can't remember that, just remember the phrase API. If you ever get on an interview and you're nervous and you get stuck, remember API and find the words from that. Now, most of the languages today that anybody would want to code in is object-oriented. Java, Python, Ruby, C++, Visual Basic, PHP, they're all object-oriented languages. But let me give you an example of how these four pillars are made up and what they do for object-oriented programming. In this example, let's talk about inheritance. Inheritance is something that makes sense to everybody. It's an English word. It makes sense. Why? Because one person's inheriting from another. A father or a son passes it down to their child. So that makes sense. So to me, this is the easiest one to get your arm around. The example I've outlined here is that we have a master bedroom object. Remember, everything we point to, we're going to call it an object. So the master bedroom object has in it a bed with blue sheets, a nightstand that's blue, a dresser that's blue, and a PlayStation. The guest bedroom is going to inherit from the master bedroom. So what does it end up having? The exact same thing. It's inheritance. So it's going to end up with a bed with blue sheets, a nightstand that's blue, and a dresser that's blue, and of course, it's going to inherit the PlayStation. So inheritance seems to be straightforward and clear. Now, polymorphism. The word polymorphism means, poly means many, morphism means to change. So in the example here, we first have inheritance, where the master bedroom object is going to be passed to the guest bedroom object. So the guest bedroom object is inheriting from the master bedroom object. Some people call that the parent-child relationship, okay? The guest bedroom being the child object, okay? In this case, we're going to use polymorphism to change the guest bedroom object. Why? Because with polymorphism, maybe the person doesn't like blue sheets, blue nightstand, and blue dresser. So they turn around in this example, I've changed the bed to Wu-Tang, nightstand to black, and the dresser to black, and I left the PlayStation the same. So you can see how polymorphism and inheritance kind of go hand in hand. Another example would be abstraction. Abstraction is a little more difficult to get your arm around, but let me see, can I explain it this way? Let's go back to the original example of the master bedroom object and how the guest bedroom object is going to inherit from the master bedroom object, okay? Then the guest bedroom object is going to do polymorphism and change everything that it just inherited. And the example I use, we changed it to Wu-Tang Clan sheets, and we changed the nightstand to black and the dresser to black, okay? But I've introduced another object here called the living room object. The living room object has a sofa, side table, and also has a PlayStation. So without abstraction, what do we notice? We notice that the PlayStation is in every single object. So thus we have duplication of code, or in this case, duplication of the PlayStation, okay? Without abstraction. Now with abstraction, what do? We remove the PlayStation from the master bedroom object, We remove the PlayStation from the guest bedroom object and we leave it in the living room object. And anytime the guest bedroom object needs it, it'll call the living room object. Anytime the master bedroom object needs it, it'll call the living room object. Why is abstraction important? It's important because if we want to use this in code, we would have the PlayStation in three different objects. And every time you wanted to make a change, you would have to go into these three objects and make a change to PlayStation. So we leave it in one object using abstraction. We put it in one object. So now we've covered inheritance, we've covered polymorphism, and we've covered abstraction. The last one that's remaining is encapsulation. Encapsulation, the definition, and should you Google it or look it up, is implemented by using access modifiers to define the scope, the visibility of a class member of objects. When I read this the first time I read it, I had no idea what they were talking about. What does it mean? It means when you create an object, if you want others to use your object, you can put encapsulation on it. If you use the word public as the example I'm showing you here, then everyone can use your object. If you put protected in front of your object, in this case, like master bedroom object or the guest bedroom object, if you put protected in front of it, it can be accessed from the same object or the derived object. There's private and there's internal, which we'll discuss later. I don't want you to get your mind all twisted up. I just want to make sure you understand how encapsulation happens. It happens with access modifiers. So now if I go forward one more time and introduce code, because I think you're ready for it. I don't want you to trip out or tighten your butt. Just, you can handle this. Here you see one line of code, okay? I'm creating a class, which is an object, as you can see by the orange arrow, okay? Also, I'm using encapsulation. I'm putting the word public in front of it to say that everybody can use this object, okay? And I'm introducing something new to you so that when we get to code, it doesn't throw you. And you can start off writing code this way. I'm using something called camel case. I left the definition here below. Camel case is the practice of writing phrases without spaces or punctuation, indicating the separation of words with a single capitalized letter. So, when I introduce the master bedroom, the M is capitalized and the B in bedroom is capitalized, and there's no space between the words. That's writing in camel case. Okay? Between the brackets is where you would put your code, which we're not going to get in today, but I wanted to introduce that to you so you have an understanding that all code goes in brackets. I remember when I was learning how to code, I used to leave brackets out. Of course, it didn't work, didn't compile, didn't do nothing. So brackets are very important. And most new students will always leave out the brackets because it's not normal to throw everything in brackets. But we knew that in parentheses in math, we always did it. But here in code, you have to have brackets. Okay? So now, just to recap a little, we have polymorphism, abstraction, encapsulation, inheritance, which make up object-oriented programming. And from that, we end up with classes, we end up with objects. And the term you're always going to hear is an object is an instance of a class. And you'll learn more about that when we get into coding. So what have we talked about today? What have we chopped up today? We talked about the four pillars of object-oriented programming. One being abstraction, the second being polymorphism, inheritance, and encapsulation. And if you can't remember all that, remember A, Pi, and try to figure it out from there. We talked about objects and classes. We talked about an object as an instance of a class. I showed you in C# code how when we write class, we're talking about an object, okay? I also gave you a little intro into coding in that you know that you have to have an access modifier sitting in front of your class that denotes how it's encapsulated. And we also talked about camel case. that when you're naming your object, you want to capitalize each letter in a new word, and there's no spaces in between it. Okay? Now, part two, we will start talking about code. We'll start coding in C# so that you can see how we use these four pillars, how important they are to code. If you have any questions or comments, you can go to 558parksidetech.com. You can also find us on YouTube and Spotify, Anchor, and podcasts. Thank you for joining us today. And if you enjoyed the content, please feel free to subscribe or join us at 558parksidetech.com. And remember, program or be programmed, and be greater than your greatest excuse and learn tech. For life and tech waits for no one. Peace.
Yeah, 558 Parkside Tech in effect, that tech, 558 Parkside Tech in effect, tap in the future, let me introduce ya, 558 Parkside Tech, about to